cheeky backheel.
With ease, Miguel Aziz's first goal for Portsmouth.
Into the path of Smith-Rowe, into the box. Smith-Rowe scores!
A really deserved first goal in Huddersfield Town colours.
All right, we're back with another episode of Away From Hail End, and I'm very excited for those of you that have now found me on YouTube or have found me on TikTok and have been directed to the YouTube. What once was a simply an audio podcast for two seasons and a little bit of this third season is now adding a visual element where you're going to have highlight clips of the things that I'm talking about, give you a little more context to what these players are doing on loan, because yes, it's nice that I can kind of break it down for you and tell you all those things that you didn't do. Well, you weren't watching Brooke Norton Cuffey and Millwall play against Sheffield Wednesday during the Arsenal game. If you weren't watching Mika Bierith and Motherwell struggle in another match, if you weren't watching the Arthur Okonkwo effect for Wrexham and you haven't done the research, you haven't had the time to watch the clips, well, hopefully you'll get some of that here to go along with our player profile, some highlights from some youth games, and really just breaking down the things that I'm talking about with some visual help. Of course, if you listen on Spotify, you listen on Apple Podcasts, that's where you have found me for the past couple of years. Continue to listen there. It will not change on those platforms. But for those of you joining me now on YouTube who are seeing my clips on TikTok and Twitter, enjoy it. I think it's going to add a whole nother level to Away From Hail End. And today, not only is a very exciting day because of all of those things I mentioned, but we're also going to talk about and do a player profile on my favorite underrated gem from Hail End, Bradley Ibrahim, a player who has been very consistent, a player who gets absolutely no chatter about him from any of the accounts that you follow on Twitter. I promise. I do the research before these player profiles and often use kind of an aggregation format to come up with some of the things that I say. And I can promise you that nobody else talks about Bradley Ibrahim except for me. And I've been talking about him since this account started over 2 years ago. Bradley Ibrahim caught my eye immediately, a profile that we do not have at Hail End otherwise and have not had at Hail End. And I'm very excited to talk about him today with all of you. Bradley Ibrahim is a 19-year-old kid who was born in Macclesfield, England, should be the next Hail End prospect to find his way into the first team. He stands at 5'9" tall, or 1.78 meters. Bradley's presence is always felt in midfield. A tackling maestro, Ibrahim reads the game as well as anyone, eats up space like Pac-Man, and makes powerful runs on the ball. A destroyer, a powerhouse, an engine, a true number six with technique, carrying ability, and instinct. Bradley's earliest memories all revolve around football, whether it was watching the Premier League on TV, showing up to the local goal center in his jeans and Timberlands, or playing in PE class. Ibrahim's life has always been centered around kicking a football. Weirdly, Bradley has a memory of playing football in his neighborhood at 4 years old and being spotted by a Brentford scout who is now working at Arsenal. However, it wasn't Brentford who signed Ibrahim at a young age. It was QPR, after Bradley did trials with Tottenham, Crystal Palace, and Chelsea as well. During his time at QPR, Ibrahim enjoyed playing in every position imaginable. In an interview with Arsenal.com, Bradley said, quote, "I just loved it. Center back, center forward, winger. I would play anywhere I was asked to play. I've been everywhere, and I think that's really helped me in terms of my development as a player." At age 13, QPR told Ibrahim they were going to release him. Bradley didn't let that deter him from his goal, working hard that summer to get fitter, faster, and stronger. He spent his extra time playing for a Sunday league team and had the opportunity to play in a six-a-side summer tournament. Well, luck would have it, and Arsenal happened to have a scout there who called Ibrahim and offered him a chance to join Hail End. Ibrahim remembers the day vividly. Quote, "You know what? I can still remember how I felt that day. You've got to remember that I grew up supporting Arsenal too, so it meant so much to me. I was shocked more than anything else. I've still got the photo of my first day at Hail End. Those memories are hard to forget." As we all know, Hail Enders, especially the midfielders, are most well known for their technical skills. Little touches of the football in tight spaces, incredible vision, and supreme weight of passing. Ibrahim saw this immediately in training and knew he wasn't near the standard needed. But over time, Bradley worked hard and closed the gap, becoming a maestro himself. Over time, he made his way through the ranks, establishing himself as a stalwart at each level in the academy. At 16 years old, in March of 2021, Ibrahim made his debut for the under-18 side in a 4-3 win over Reading. Bradley ended the season making 4 appearances for the under-18s, adding 2 assists. In February of 2022, at just 17 years old, he made his under-21 debut, playing at right back, out of position, for 90 minutes in a 1-1 draw with Leicester. Later that year, in October, days before he turned 18, Ibrahim made the bench for Arsenal's first team in the Europa League, and again he did a few weeks later. This season, Bradley has become an anchor for the under-21s, starring as the number 6 in the Premier League 2, the EFL Trophy, and with the under-19s in the UEFA Youth League. In his most recent appearance in the Premier League 2, Ibrahim scored a goal and assisted twice as Arsenal triumphed over Brighton. And then just over this past weekend, Bradley Ibrahim made the bench for Arsenal in the Premier League. Ibrahim has signed his scholarship with Hale End a couple years ago in the summer of 2021 and his first professional contract with the club in March of 2022. Bradley Ibrahim is a leader of men, a force to be reckoned with, and a general in midfield. As a number 6 profile needs to, he eats up open space off the ball with his combination of running power and anticipation. Bradley is strong and fast, breaking on loose balls with intent and determination. He'll catch up with attackers in midfield, but more often than not, he's positioned himself correctly to keep play in front of him. However, Ibrahim is not scared to go to ground and make a crunching tackle when he sees fit. His long legs and flexibility help to win the ball and rarely get himself into trouble with the referee, receiving 0 red cards in his 64 matches at the under-18, under-19, and under-21 levels. Bradley is a transition stopper. He'll go shoulder to shoulder with anyone, bodying attackers off the ball and winning the ball back. Over the past 18 months, Bradley's learned the importance of transition creation. Often winning the ball back, Ibrahim is capable of getting his head up and starting the attack in the same motion as his defensive action. A passing range with very little bias, Ibrahim can open up his body and ping balls to his outlets on the wing or break the lines through midfield. He has a very important skill not all players learn or are capable of: the ability to play straight balls through defense and into the path of an attacker. There's a certain overspin that needs to be created to do this effectively, and Bradley has this talent. He also has the on-ball capabilities to wriggle out of tight spaces and burst into the opponent's half, carrying the ball and releasing a shot from distance when he deems necessary. Where Bradley lacks in ball manipulation, he succeeds in carrying posture and ball protection. Long strides allow for Ibrahim to simply glide past defenders, breaking the press and creating odd man attacking situations. There's an innate feeling of awe watching Bradley Ibrahim's athleticism. It's different than what you'd expect. But when some long-legged midfielders feel clunky, he feels smooth and suave. Each touch he takes has a purpose: buying time to make a deadly action or holding a defender off until an opportunity presents itself. A patient mind and body combining for the perfect midfield profile. A player so clearly comfortable in dangerous situations that you feel calm every time he's on the ball. The future for Bradley Ibrahim is seemingly bright. Mikel Arteta has chosen him to train with the first team countless times and now called him up to the Premier League squad during this most recent injury crisis. But Bradley doesn't need Arteta's backing to believe in himself. He has a confident head on his shoulders. Ibrahim told Football Daily when asked who he'd like to play against.
Jude Bellingham, you know, he's tall, athletic, a bit like me, so it'd be a good challenge and a good battle against him, hopefully in a few years.
Hopefully Ibrahim gets a chance to debut for Arsenal's first team this season. His profile fits the team perfectly, with a great understanding for space and controlled play. A future replacement for Jorginho is right here in Hale End. As I mentioned at the top, Bradley Ibrahim is just simply one of my favorite profiles. A true number 6 who's best covering space, who's best identifying when to go in for a tackle and when to just protect his back line. A true midfielder who's happy to step between the center backs and control play from the back line or dribble through defenses when needed. Overall, I'm just thrilled to watch Bradley Ibrahim get the chance to train with the first team and sit on the bench in the Premier League, and I truly do believe he'll get his chance sooner rather than later. Now that we got our player profile out of the way, let's move on to our loan players and how they've been performing. Charlie Patino, always who we go to first. Tough week for Charlie. He got a 30-minute red card against Sunderland. Both the yellows were honestly a little bit harsh. He was a little late on the first one. The second one, he really didn't make nearly any contact with the player. If anything, Patino is the one whose foot was stepped on. But nonetheless, 30 minutes, Charlie Patino gone. And of course, because of that, he missed out on the weekend due to suspension. So Charlie Patino now off with the under-21s to play in some Euro qualifiers. Hopefully he'll get some minutes. He did not get any minutes in the previous international break. But we will hopefully get a chance to talk about him next week and what he's done with England. But nothing to really catch you up with on his Swansea performances. Brooke Norton Cuffey is firing. He's firing. There's no other thing you could possibly say. He has found a newfound confidence with the manager leaving, a new manager coming in. He's really just at his best now. And the best that I've seen him since Lincoln, honestly. He had some really good moments last year, both at Rotherham and Coventry. But this is the most confident that I've seen Brooke Norton Cuffey at any point in the last 2 years. He played 64 minutes against Southampton, 8 of 9 passing, 1 key pass, 3 of 4 successful dribbles. And he was just carrying so much more threat than we've seen all season. And for a lot of last year, he was excellent in interplay. He was flying down the wings. He was willing to take on his man, whether or not he really had an opportunity to. And because of his pace and his strength, he was able to make things happen. And then what do we say about his match against Sheffield Wednesday? I mean, he was just spectacular under new manager Joe Edwards. He went back to playing at right back after that couple of performances and right mid. And if you recall, I mentioned that I think this could be great for his development. Give him a little bit more freedom. Allow him to regain that confidence, taking men on, creating dangerous opportunities, get more crosses in. And what do you know? After a few matches at right mid, going back to right back, he has his best game as an outlet. Doing his job defensively, doing his job in midfield, and being creative. I mean, what more can you ask for from Brooke Norton Cuffey? And we hope this is not just a new manager bounce. We hope this is the Brooke Norton Cuffey that we thought we'd be seeing for the last 12 months or so, and what we saw a lot of in his youth days. Mika Biarif, what else is there to say about him other than, wow, he cannot stop scoring. Every time he is on the pitch, he is getting a goal or an assist in a time when his team needs him. He comes on against Aberdeen at halftime. He gets a goal. He comes on against St. Johnstone late on and ties it up, gets a goal. He is just fantastic. He earned himself a start then. He did pretty well against Kilmarnock, created a lot of danger. He nearly scored on a volley after creating space with just kind of his physical skills. And you might not see a lot by seeing this clip, but he has this innate ability to kind of use his low center of gravity and his understanding of kind of anticipation to give himself the opportunity to score goals and meet balls in the air, right? A lot of the goals you've seen are him kind of meeting a half volley or him predicting a defender might miss this or a ball falling to him. And that kind of anticipation, you'll get a lot of goals, a lot of lucky bounces come your way. And Mika Biarif was very unlucky not to score against Kilmarnock. And what's incredible, truly, about all these Mika Biarif goals is the array of different finishes, right? So far this year, just in the few matches he's played, and obviously the loads of goals he scored, we've seen half volleys. We've seen flying boots coming across to meet volleys. He's drawn penalties and then scored those penalties. He's been bossing center backs with his physical and technical skills, and he's finished low into bottom corners away from goalkeepers. It's not just happens. It's not just worldies. It's this large array of goals that makes me so confident that he'll succeed at the senior level. He knows how to be a footballer through and through and not just a pure striker. And that's why I like Mika Biarif's profile so much. He then also got the start in a 2-1 loss to Hearts. And truthfully, he struggled to get any service all match. But he worked really hard off the ball. He was making runs into space. He was winning aerial duels. He was driving through midfield when he had the chance to get on the ball and he saw space in front of him. He was relentless. And that's what he does. And that's why he gets goals. He's not going to score every single match, but the reason he gets goals is because he works tirelessly off the ball to get into those spaces, to get into those opportunities, to create for his teammates. And Motherwell have a real gem on their hands who's going to save them a lot of points this year when they are in struggling positions, which they seem to be in. Arthur Okonkwo just continues to be excellent for Wrexham. He played in that 2-1 win over Mansfield Town in the FA Cup. He made 5 saves. And I feel like I'm a broken record when I talk about Arthur Okonkwo and his positioning, but truthfully, it's just taken such a huge leap in just 12 months. If you remember at Crew, he was constantly getting beat in strange situations, and he's just really learned how to cover his angles, especially in 1v1s, and with the size of his frame and his arms and his legs, the guy is going to make so many saves in 1v1s and so many saves that you don't expect. He should be able to cover the entire goal from nearly every angle, and he's learning how to do that. I mean, in this match, and you'll have seen it, the goal he gave up was an absolute worldie from outside the box, hit perfectly through the back of the net into the top corner. No chance for Okonkwo, but he has been excellent, and he continued that with a clean sheet in a 2-0 win over Gillingham for clean sheets and only allowing 8 goals, less than a goal per match in League Two. We're not going to be complaining about that for Arthur Okonkwo. Going up a level in the English Football League system, Omar Rekik. He didn't start in this first match, but played 72 minutes against Exeter City in the FA Cup in a 2-0 win. He came on for an injured player and played right back. He then played the full 90 at right back in a 2-1 win over Peterborough. I really don't love him as a fullback, but the right side is much better for his body orientation. He doesn't get dragged around and doesn't get kind of fooled with and leave open spaces as much as he was at left back. He seems to be able to understand space better and cover his bases, and also is operating quite smoothly up the wing. If you recall, when he plays most comfortably, I like him at left center back, right? I think he's able to dribble into that half space and kind of spray balls with his array of passing. But when he's at left back, I don't feel that he's comfortable being all the way on the touchline. At right back, I do feel that Omar Rekik is really comfortable kind of using his right foot to shield the ball, using his body to shield the ball and find good play, balls into the channels down the line, and then playing line-breaking passes into the middle. He was 28 of 31 passing in this match, 3 of 3 aerial duels won. However, he was 0 of 5 on ground duels, and I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that he is not confident in tackling, and that's always been an issue from the youth level. He is not a great tackler, and when he dives in, he often misses and gets beat or is drawing yellow cards on himself, and we don't like to see either of those things, and he did just that in the next match. Playing at left center back and right back, they kind of switched formations throughout the match, and he did all right in a 1-1 draw with Cheltenham, but he did get a yellow card, as I mentioned. That's his 4th already in the league. He's only started 7 matches. 34 of 46 passing, 4 of 8 long balls. He made 5 passes into the final third, 1 of 1 tackles, and 5 of 12 duels won. He's getting more comfortable with Wigan. I mean, Wigan are been struggling as well. They've been struggling since he went there in January of last year. But, you know, Rekik really hasn't had the opportunity to find a consistent position for them. And until he does and he gets a run of games, you know, even with the same kind of defensive pairings, I think he's going to struggle to be a consistent defender, and who knows what the future looks like for an inconsistent defender. Salah Eddine Nulatamhan, a name you've heard me talk about a lot for the last 2 years, for somebody who really hasn't played a lot of football, but he has been on 2 different loan spells, and now he's finally playing for FC Den Bosch. He played 61 minutes in a 2-1 loss in the Dutch Cup, playing in a role that he's very comfortable in, and the one he played for and had great success for Arsenal's under-21s 2 years ago now. And that's that left-center mid-8 role that we talk about so much with Arsenal's first team. He was 17 of 26 passing, 4 of 7 on long balls. He won his only ground duel, and he made 1 interception. He actually worked really hard defensively, and I'm impressed by how physical he's become. He's grown, first of all, in height. He's grown in stature, and he's confident in getting into passing. He did then get the next match off, and I think that's just strictly for match fitness purposes, because the match after that, he played 88 minutes in a 1-0 loss to Emmen, but he was honestly excellent. He was so creative. He was truly the only midfield outlet that Den Bosch had, and this was not a fun match to watch. You think you've struggled to do your job at any point? Try and watch 90 minutes of Den Bosch versus Emmen. Den Bosch really, really struggled to build play up in any way, shape, or form. They try to play out from back, but more often than not, they go goalkeeper, left center back, left back, and then the left back just plays a ball, a looping ball, up to the 2 strikers who try to win the second ball. It's not pretty to watch, but when they're able to link up with Salah Eddine Nulatamhan in midfield, he drives through midfield, he makes great passes, forward passes, progressive passes, the type of thing we've seen. And when he receives the ball in the final third, he's got an eye for goal. he nearly scored a fantastic goal, the same type of goal he used to score for Arsenal under 21s all the time, dribbling onto his right foot, a couple of fake shots, a couple of little body feints, and releasing when he makes the space. He released into that bottom left corner, and the goalie made a great save. But Salah Eddine Ulaadimhand is back and healthy, and I'm very excited to watch him play. And as you've heard me talk about with him and Den Bosch, I finally got to see him and Gedi and Zelalem play in a pivot together. And I was a lot more excited than I should have been for that. It wasn't as pretty as I thought it would be, but still nonetheless, a lot of fun to watch. And I'm excited to see what he does for the rest of this year. Let's move into a little bit more obscure of leagues. Catalan Sergean with Rapid Bucharest played 62 minutes in a 0-0 draw in the Romanian Cup. Really didn't get on the ball too much from what I saw. He was then on the bench for the 2-1 win in the league and played 17 minutes in a 0-0 draw with Sepsi. Not exactly sure who they are. That's the Romanian league, of course. Nathan Butler Oyedehi, he played 48 minutes in a 5-1 loss to AFC Wimbledon and then did not feature against Wigan. Tyrese Jean-Jules, as I've been saying for a couple weeks, he is back in training, but they're being very careful with him, as they should be, a player who's often injured. Alex Kirk and Keto Taylor-Hart are both not in the Bromley squad as of now. That is all we know. There isn't a lot of reporting on it. I believe Alex Kirk is injured. I think Keto Taylor-Hart is just out of the squad. Mauro Bandiera has not made the squad since October 14th. I don't know what the future looks like for him at Colchester. He has been seen back at London Colney and watched the Arsenal under 21 match recently. My guess is there'll be a recall in January. And depending on other outgoings in terms of loans, he could potentially spend the rest of the season with Arsenal's under 21s. Billy Vigar, he's played quite a bit for Eastbourne Borough. He played a few matches over the last week, played the full 90 against Chippenham Town and against Maidstone United in the league. Then he played the full 90 against Braintree Town and scored a goal. He came flying into the box late, met a cross, and scored a lovely looping header into the top corner. And then Henry Jeffcott, he did not make the squad against Middlesbrough's under 21 in the most recent match for Derby. Other than that, international break is coming up. We've got a Mario Kosier-Dewberry and Lino Sousa featuring for the England under 19s. And as I mentioned, you've got Brooke Norton-Cuffey and Charlie Patino featuring for the England under 21s. There may be a few others here and there. The squads haven't all been announced yet, but we will keep you up to date at Haaland Productions, as we always do. Thank you very much for listening on Spotify or wherever you find your podcasts. If this is your first time listening on the YouTube, it would be your first time listening on the YouTube because it's the first time that I'm posting there. If you found us there, subscribe, like, comment. You know how it goes. Find me on TikTok as well for kind of shorter clips on these types of things. And I'm excited to be bringing you guys this kind of new format. Let's see how it goes. We'll experiment with it. And let me know what other things you'd like to see, whether it's just more graphics, more highlight clips, whatever it might be. We're playing with it. We're finding out what works best. And we'll be back next week.